Welcome to another video from the Heart Factory. It's been a while since I posted my last video, probably around 6 months, and I hope to post more videos in near future more regularly. During this waiting time, we have reached, or my channel or the Heart Factory has reached 3000 subscribers, and I thank each one of you for subscribing to my channel. Basically, it's an educational channel and I tend to post videos that may benefit the beginner. So I thank each one of you for subscribing to this channel, The Heart Factory, and we are growing day by day. Continuing our series on the cardiopulmonary bypass, the current videos will be on venous cannulation. The last few videos were on the reservoirs, the arterial cannulae, the venous cannula, and the technique of arterial cannulation. And now the next few videos will be on the technique of venous cannulation for cardiopulmonary bypass, either for mitral valve replacement or for aortic valve replacement or for coronary artery bypass grafting, even in the setting of mix, say either a right axillary thoracotomy or lower mini sternotomy. Certain simple modifications will make our life easier to cannulate the venous system and establish a cardiopulmonary bypass. So without wasting much time, let's go ahead with the videos. So the first part happens to be the basic considerations or the basics one has to know prior to understanding the venous drainage aspects of a cardiopulmonary bypass. Now, how the venous blood drains? It drains by the difference in pressure. Always blood flows from a higher pressure to a lower pressure. So therefore, if the patient is at a higher level than the upper level of the blood in the venous reservoir, then this difference by itself creates a flow of blood from the patient into the venous reservoir. The second thing is the vacuum assist. Now, if you reduce the pressure within the reservoir by means of vacuum, then the difference of pressure between the patient and the reservoir increases, thereby also increasing the flow from the patient to the venous reservoir. And the third aspect one has to keep in mind is the resistance that is offered by the tubing for the blood to flow. So one has to remember the Poiseuille's law that resistance is nothing but viscosity and is inversely proportional to the fourth power of the radius of the tube. So this even applies to BT shunt. So you should always keep the tubing length short to have better flow to the venous reservoir. Now, how much blood flows into the reservoir? It depends on the blood volume of the patient at the time of going on bypass, the patient height with respect to the upper level of the blood level in the reservoir, whether it is central cannulation or peripheral cannulation, whether it is single cannulation or bicaval cannulation. The amount of blood flow also depends on the resistance that is offered by the tubing, the circuit, and also by the configuration of the circuit. What I mean is whether it is a bicaval, a Y on Y, or a single connection, as in case of a two-stage venous cannula. Now, even the selection of the cannula affects the flow, and even the type of cannulation affects the flow. Now, what cannulas you select is dependent on the body surface area of the patient. Not only body surface area, it's also dependent on certain clinical situations like a volume overloaded state. That means there is more volume in the patient. You need to have a bigger venous cannula to drain that extra amount of blood that is there in the heart. Also, high output states. You can refer to textbooks for high output states. Even in high output states, you need to have a bigger cannula to drain enough of blood into the cardiopulmonary bypass circuit, and that also involves pregnancy as body volume is increased in pregnancy. Central cannulation always gives better venous drainage as against peripheral venous cannulation, and if you are doing peripheral venous cannulation, taking the help of vacuum assist is always helpful so that much of the venous blood is drained into the circuit by means of vacuum. the standard and the most appropriate being central cannulation. I mean bicaval cannulation with caval snares. It gives total cardiopulmonary bypass, good venous return to the reservoir. Now the other basics one has to consider with regards to the venous drainage are that gravity plays an important role, that is so called siphonage. So one has to make sure that there is no airlock in the circuit, or lest there will be obstruction to the blood flow within the venous line. The other aspect one has to keep in mind, or one has to know, is that 60% of the circulation is within the venous system, 30% is in the arterial system, and 5% is in the arterioles. So the patient height to the upper reservoir level is very important. I'm stressing this quite often, so that an adequate height gives rise to emptying of the heart into the venous reservoir whilst initiating cardiopulmonary bypass. And always keep the tubing short so that there is less resistance to the blood flow, as referred to by the Poiseuille's law. Now, if you use excessive drainage, what happens is the blood vessel collapses around the holes of the venous cannula, thereby leading to cavitation or so-called chatter. So, if you use a bigger cannula in a smaller vein, or a smaller cannula with excessive drainage, that causes collapse of the vessel around the cannula, leading to chatter or cavitation, and one can deal with it by just applying some clamp on the venous line. Low prime circuits with application of vacuum to the venous circuit to the extent of minus 20 to minus 40 helps in controlling the suck from the heart to the reservoir, and in this aspect one has to keep in mind that the tip of the venous cannula is the most important limiting factor. So bigger the cannula, better the drainage. However, one has to keep in mind that the vessel you are cannulating should also be big. Coming to basics, one has to understand in adult that the SVC drains 1/3 of the body volume and the IVC drains 2/3 of the venous volume into the cardiac system. And I am repeating, 60% of the blood is in the venous system, 30% is in the arterial system, and 5% is in the arteriolar system. So based on the type of cannulation, whether it is single cannula, whether it is two-stage cannula, or it is bicaval cannulation, based on the clinical necessity, the venous drainage depends on these types of cannulation. If you have a single cannula, it alone drains IVC, SVC, coronary sinus, and the tibiasin system. If it is bicaval cannula, one has to make arrangements to drain the coronary sinus blood and the tibiasin blood. Now, what happens when you use a single cannula to drain the venous blood into the cardiopulmonary bypass circuit? Single cannula is always used as an emergency. It drains much of the blood SVC and IVC into the cardiopulmonary bypass circuit, including the coronary sinus and the tibiasin system. Is useful in situations where you need short CPB support, especially when you are coming off bypass after having done a case with bicaval cannulation. You can convert it into single cannula, wait for the hemodynamics, and then come off. Problem is, with the change in position of the heart, the venous return also changes with single cannula, and the heart also gets to get rewarmed quite quickly with the single cannula. So that is one of the drawbacks. Plus, you can't use this cannulation technique when you have to open the right heart. For any clinical situations wherein you need to open the right heart, or in some situations where you have to have access to the mitral valve, cannulating both the SVC and IVC, and in turn snaring them, gives rise to a phenomenon called total cardiopulmonary bypass. So what it does is, after snaring the SVC and IVC, the whole blood from the SVC and IVC goes to the reservoir. Now one may wonder what happens to the blood from the coronary sinus and the tibiasin system. And the blood from these two systems obviously have to be drained by opening the RA or by a small vent in the right atrium. So such a situation is called total cardiopulmonary bypass. Mind you, the coronary sinus blood is increased in patients with left SVC and one has to identify the left SVC and cannulate it separately if it is big enough to avoid flooding of the operative field when opening the right atrium. So bicaval cannulation with caval snares is the preferred method for any situation where you need access to the right heart to avoid air getting into the circuit and also to empty the right heart and the right ventricle adequately. In situations where you don't need to have access to the right heart but still need adequate emptying of the heart, one can use the cavoatrial cannulation, which is nothing but a two-stage venous cannula, tip of which will be in the IVC and drains the lower body, and the other, the mid-body opening, drains the coronary sinus, the SVC and the TBSN system. Therefore, it drains both the right atrium and the inferior vena cava. So this is nothing but a two-stage cannulation. This gives rise to something called the partial cardiopulmonary bypass. It's useful in patients who are undergoing aortic valve replacement, in patients undergoing pump-assisted CABG, and it's useful in emergencies as well. But it's not useful if you have to open the right atrium. Now, ear lock is one of the phenomena which may cause or which may lead to venous obstruction and distension of the heart. So one has to make sure that the blood from the venous cannula are flowing smoothly into the venous reservoir and there is no ear lock. What happens is if there is a ear lock, there is distension of the heart and there is low venous return. This is very commonly seen when you open the SVC or IVC with a very large incision and the cannula is smaller and you're not snugging enough to occlude the opening in the veins around the cannula. When there is kink in the tubing, when the patient height is not enough from the reservoir level, or in a larger patient you are using the smaller cannula, mind you, tip of the venous cannula is the rate limiting step for venous drainage in cardiopulmonary bypass. So one has to give importance to all these aspects to avoid distension of the heart and reduced venous drainage. The other aspects one has to take into consideration is the position of the cannula. That is, if you pass on the SVC cannula into the azygous vein or the IVC cannula into the hepatic vein or the RA cannula into the left atrium across an ASD, then you will have obstruction too, or you may not have enough venous drainage into the reservoir, or there may be air lock on opening the right atrium. You can damage the SVC or IVC whilst snaring, so be careful not to damage the vessels while snaring. One has to be careful to put the snares away from the azygous vein and the sinus node to avoid damage to these two structures. Now there can be laceration of the SVC, IVC or RA due to poor technique, and if that is happening, one has to deal with it accordingly. More important is injury to the SVC and IVC while passing the snares, and if that is the case, one has to deal with it by going on bypass, then suturing the area directly with fine rolling sutures. The other aspect or complication of cannulation of the venous system is atrial arrhythmias, and after you come off bypass and after tying the purse ring sutures, you may stenose the SVC or IVC. This is rather rare, but that is still a possibility. The other aspects of venous cannulation is low cardiac output, especially when you're cannulating the IVC by pushing the heart away. One can always end up in a hypotensive state. So it's always better to cannulate the IVC after you go on bypass with an SVC so that you are in a controlled state. And always venous cannulation is done after arterial cannulation, because any loss that may happen after venous cannulation is taken care by perfusing through the aortic cannula. In patients requiring peripheral venous cannulation, especially the trend is now with respect to minimal invasive cardiac surgery, certain things has to be borne in mind. Peripheral cannulation is usually done when central cannulation is contraindicated, either because of aortic disease, aortic aneurysm, aortic dissection, or in certain patients electively it's done in redo situations, or in patients for MICS, as I said before, you can either use a two-stage cannula or single cannula for IVC, open the chest and then cannulate the SVC, make it bicaval, or you have multi-stage cannulas as well. And to increase the venous return, you can take the help of vacuum assist to the extent of minus 20 to minus 40 millimeters of mercury to improve the venous drainage. For patients who have RA tumors or any patient with renal carcinoma with tumor extending into the right atrium, peripheral venous cannulation is quite helpful. It is the method of choice in the emergency suite. Patients who collapse, you can use peripheral vessels to cannulate, and also in patients to establish extracorporeal membrane oxygenation, that is ECMO, be it veno arterial or veno venous. So these are the basics one has to keep in mind, ladies and gentlemen. 65% of the blood is in the venous circuit, 30% in the arterial circuit, and 5% in the arterioles. One has to pay great importance to the venous drainage in cardiopulmonary bypass. And the next video will deal about the actual techniques across various scenarios. As usual, if you have some comments or if you have some recommendations for me to improve my videos, I would really appreciate if you can drop them in the comment section so that I can apply them in my next videos. If you like my videos, please click the like button and do not forget to subscribe to my channel. Please ring the bell just to be notified of my next video in time. Suggestions are almost welcome. Request you to keep watching this space for more videos. Till then, thank you.